So what I'm doing now, I got my little pieces from the record, and the joint is coming from the Course Day 10 joint off of the Fantastic Planet album. So right now I'm just pitching everything down so I can get some of that bass, so I can get some of that bass out. I'm gonna chop this off. Chopping some of these ends off, you know what I'm saying? Cause I want to be able to, you know, trigger that. Most of the time, if I'm working on the 3000, most of the time I'm not triggering my samples mono or poly. I'm turning note off on, so that I, you know, if I push it, it plays. If I let it go, it stops. Now it's different on the 25. On the 25, I may do a Roddy Rod, or a, you know what I'm saying, where I could tell he probably has a lot of things mono, and a 25 is a good machine for that.
How do you determine how you want the tempo of your beat?
Well, once I get my samples and I find out the pitch that I want them at, for example, most of these are negative 10, and I got, once I chop the sounds and I know, and I start getting the beat idea in my head, I know off the break that this one's going to be like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. You know what I'm saying? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
So you let the sample determine the BPM.
It depending on how it sounds. Like if it's, and also depending on.
I always do drums first, so I usually.
Oh yeah.
Set the BPMs first.
That's what's up. Like what I do, it depends on the sound. Like for this particular sound, for me right now, it's like, since I already got the drums, I haven't sequenced them yet, of course, but now that I have, you know, how I want the sequence to go, I'm already thinking of how I want the drums to be, but I know I'm gonna already sample the joint in 4/4, you know what I'm saying? So it's gonna basically be a 4-bar loop, you know what I'm saying? And as the skeleton, and then I'll add on from there. So so right now I'm 2. Okay, so like I was saying, so it's 88.3, and I like to set my BPMs at like an odd number, an even number, and then an odd number, especially if I'm not using the quantization, like, because then that helps, if somehow it helps it to loop right, if you know what I'm saying, as far as the 3000 is concerned. It's just the way the algorithms or whatever, you know, works on this machine, and I found it works on other machines too, but let me see if I got the BPMs right. Okay, so you notice that the okay, now let me try. So now that I got that down, I'm automatically, all right, got that done. What other elements am I gonna add? So right now I'm on drum mode, so I'm a... At this stage, I'm trying to figure out, based on the sound, do I want it to be a boom bap beep? Do I want it to be like a Dilla style lazy drums? Do I want it to be like a 70s band? You know what I'm saying? So right now I'm feeling like... So, hi-hats now, new track. Sometimes I put my kick and snare on the same track, depending on if it's, you know, on the same like level. If I want them to be on the same level, then I'll go ahead and put it on the same track, because I'm gonna throw all this in the Pro Tools anyway. Line track number 4, I'm gonna go ahead and 16 throw this on 16 levels, and then try to match the chords up. So that last note is clashing with something, you know what I'm saying? So I'm gonna have to choose something else. Or what I love about this machine is the fact that if something, you can always utilize the filters in it. And you could do this with any machine, but because of the way this machine sounds, to me, it's like it you can use that filter to either cut off something or use the whatever that R word is, the resonance to make the pitch higher. And the way it sounds in this machine, it's almost like you can repair something if something doesn't sound right. It's almost like this machine is made for like the sound scientist beat maker, like, you know what I'm saying? And that's why I like it, because it almost makes you think about what stuff sounds like. I'm not knocking any other machines or whatever, but as far as my experience, it's like, if, you know, the 3000, if you're trying to get your sounds to be just so on every level, as far, you know, then this the best machine to get it all out and know that it's gonna be like that. And if that doesn't sound right, you can edit that out, because but you know what I'm saying, any machine can do that, but in my opinion, the 3000 is the best machine for that, because it's just the way the machine sounds and the algorithms, whatever's in it, just seems like it just makes things, you can repair sounds, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, let me get back to you. With the same sample, I'm gonna do some high pitch. Let me do something a little different. Okay, not a down button. Okay. Just making that 2 bar into a 4 bar so that I got enough room to play with. Thank you. clashing with it. See? So I'm going to erase it. Once I have my four-bar loop, if I'm doing a four-bar loop beat like this one, then what I want to do now, I'm going to be trying to look at, check and look at other at the other elements that I chop and see if I can find something in there to layer on top of it for the chorus or whatever like that. So the best thing, what I like to do with the 3000 or any machine that I've used, once I have that main part down, if I'm doing a chorus part and you want some like some high frequency sounds on it, go to that filter and use the resonance. Saying so it makes it adds a whole nother dimension to the beat. See what I'm saying? So I'm gonna add that to another track. Because it's on mono, it's cutting it off, so I'm gonna try something different. So like this, something like this, I got more to add to it, but this will be the chorus part. So this be the verse part. Maybe drop something out. So this is pretty much like what I would do with it after I finish this part of the beat. I'm gonna hit y'all with that chorus part real quick again. So now it's ready to go to Pro Tools or whatever. So let me open that up.
Did you call it now?
There's a certain type of beats that I call super chops. And what it is where I take a record, I don't add any elements to the joint, you know, to the sample. What I do is just I take all as many elements as I can out of the song, the sample, and I'll create a whole nother song. I'm not adding my own drums or anything, so. So that was one. Let me see. That was one. Here's another one right here.
Those drums are already there?
No. Oh, you know what? On this one, my bad. This one is and I just realized that myself. Number five, I have my own drums to that. Alright, so this, yeah, I really like this one, how this one turned out. And now I'm focusing on, you know, I'm just trying to get better at matching the drums with the sample now. Like, you know what I'm saying? I'm still into the boom bap thing, but I'm not as anymore. I want my drums almost to sound like it's a band within the song and not like it's like, you know,
program.
Yeah, exactly. You know what I'm saying? Thanks for giving me the word, man. I'll be going blank sometimes, man. So
you gotta find a different tag.
You said a different tag?
Yeah, for your beats.
That
little logic bomb. your logic bomb tag is not what's popping.
Oh, really?
Okay. In the streets, no.
Okay.
At least put some bass in his voice or something.
Right. Yeah. So, ladies and gentlemen, I will be taking that off the beats at this time, courtesy of your man Gadget.
Thank you. I'm just trying to help you out.
Yes, sir. Okay.
You know, you could probably just pitch it down.
Pitch it down.
Yeah.
Right. True.
It's.
It just sounds a little effeminate.
Whose voice is that?
Will you kill me if I tell you who it is?
Is it you?
It's me.
Oh.
Don't worry, man.
Dude. Do you know the jokes that's gonna come across the comments?
Man. On what?
On YouTube. Logic bomb.
No. Oh, man. So what you want to read tape for?
Oh, man.
Should I replay the joints and mute the logic bomb?
No. They didn't already heard it now.
Oh, no. Okay. All right. Forgive me.
People. And plus, didn't you put that forgive on a beat tape already? Didn't you put that tag on a beat tape?
I did. The Jill Scott Heron joint, by the way, get that, y'all. Get that. It's free. It's on my Bandcamp, logicbombmusic.bandcamp.com. It's, again, it's a free download. It was created by myself, all Jill Scott Heron samples, and it has... Heron. Yeah, but yeah, it has your man on there, and yes, it has that wonderful voice drop that my man Gadget has been telling me
to change.
Yes, ASAP. So so I will be changing that. But let me see. This is another joint.
So what do you have coming out?
Right now I got Logic Bomb Fragments, which I've been working on for some time. It has some live instrumentation on top of that. Basically, it's a mixture between joints that I created on the MP and live musical things going on in there. Drums, I'm playing the drums on there. I'm playing the horn. I'm doing all kinds of stuff, instrumentation.
Is that a French horn? What is that?
You know what? To be honest with you, when I seen it at the thrift store, I was like, ASAP, I gotta pick that up.
But what is it?
What type of horn is that? I believe it's a French horn. And it's rusty as I don't know what, but it you'll hear it in the Fragments joint. It has a nice pitch to it. Or whatever on some of the jazz joints that I have. So it's not just a hip-hop album. It's like, as far as instrumental wise, it got hip-hop on it. It has some jazzy stuff. It has some electronic music on there. So I think that would be interesting. And yeah, so that's Fragments, Fred the Fragments EP. And so that's gonna be dropping on the pretty soon. As a matter of fact,
did you just look at the calendar and just say pretty soon?
Yes, I did. Because I don't want to.
you
I don't know if you're when you're dropping this, but okay, the gotcha, video. Gotcha. So you know what I'm saying.
Pretty soon.
Right. So, but also, I'm getting some stuff finished with Judah. Big up to Judah. You know, we were in the studio together.
Shout out Hercules.
Yes, yes, sir.
AKA Judah.
Yes, sir. And he, you know, was tweaking some stuff while we was in the studio together. Got it's some very nice joints on there, R&B style stuff, and that I think that you know, for the ladies.
So you guys co-produced?
Yes, on a lot of the joints we co-produce. There's this joint that I have that I'm producing for artists that was featured on my Soul Sequences album. Her name is Elle. And we created a joint. I made a beat called Angel. When I brought it to him, he was feeling it, but he felt it needed a few touch-ups. So we just collaborated on that and came up with something real nice that when we finally record it, that's going to be on something that's dropping pretty soon, whether it's her EP or it's, you know, my... maybe a album featuring a DMV artist or something like that. So that's what's going down for right now. Also.
Oh, this is big news.
Yes.
He had to turn around for
this
one.
Yes. RDSQ. Have you heard of him? RDSQ, Rappers Deluxe Squad, consists of myself, Ronnie Ruin, a.k.a. Ronnie Ron, D-Tron, Quan, and a man by the name of Decoy, and they are right here from my side or whatever like that. It's totally D-Tron. He's 20 years old. He's a phenomenal producer. So it's gonna be a mixture of instrumentals and actual full songs. Quan sings and raps as well, and D-Tron produces and raps. Ronnie Ruin, he raps and makes beats, but he's not on the production on this particular project. And myself, I try to keep it secret, but you know, I got a few flows and things going in on there too. So check it out. I'm definitely going to be posting up something on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter once we get finished with all the recording. But yeah, I'm very excited about that because we've been working on things for years. We have folders upon folders of materials, and finally we was like, okay, we need to get something together. These been my friends for forever, and we just play around in the studio, and so we thought that maybe it was time to get you know, some material out. So also check out my man Decoy. I'ma just say that Decoy is vicious. He doesn't want me to give any details as where he's from, his rhyming style. All I'm going to say, look out for some material with him on it. Vicious MC from DC. And,
well, you just said where he's from.
Well, see, I felt like I could divulge that information suddenly. You know what I'm saying? I'll just say that he's from DC. He's from here. So, yeah, so. What else I got for you? See, I'm gonna turn that drop off.
That's alright, that's okay.
Hope you added those out. That'll be great. I'll be grateful for that.
I mean, if you like them, you know. It's...
Well, you know what? You know what I found out, Gadget? You know, one of the things that I've learned over time is that because a lot of producers are DJs first, then they produce. A lot of us who started out as making producers or making beats first have to learn over time to have a DJ's mindset. And the reason why I say that is because a lot of producers, we enjoy the beats that we make ourselves, but we gotta know what the people want. You know what I'm saying? We gotta know what the people dance to, what the people like and things. So even though I have my forte as far as what kind of beats that I like to make, I like making boom bap, but I like sample-based music. At the same time, I gotta know what people like and what people dislike. So, for example, you mentioned in a drop, even though at the time I was like, oh, I got to start putting drops in my joints, I just was like, hey, I gotta send this beat off to a few, you know, these beats off to some people, and I'm like, I need some drops. And I just threw whatever I could on there. You know what I'm saying? And if people don't like that, if that detracts from the beat, then I have to listen to that. You know what I'm saying? So that's that DJ mentality, knowing what people like and knowing what people dislike and kind of catering my beats or my instrumentation towards that. You know, while still staying myself, you know what I'm saying? While still doing my thing. So, so yeah, you know, I think that's important.
Well, I know where you got the drums from.
Yeah. Actually, you know what? I've used them a few times. I've used them before. You know what I'm talking about. You want to say it?
No.
Okay, cool.
If they don't know, they'll figure it out.
Yeah. I know heck will know off the break.
Oh, well, you left the sample in there too, so.
But I've used them before in another joints. It may be, you know, less noticeable because I took the Congo section out, if you know what I'm talking about. But when I take them, when I leave them Congos in, yes, very recognizable.
You know who I can see rhyming over your stuff?
Who?
Because you have a very eclectic style.
Mm-hmm.
MF Doom.
You know what? Say no more. As a matter of fact, my first, when we did our first Behind the Beats thing, and you asked who one MC that I will work with in the studio, that's who I mentioned. And I think it's an unorthodox style or whatever. You know what I'm saying? And I just like the way he rips on the mic. So that's, again, even to this day, I feel the same way. I will work with a Doom. So
I mean, I'm not gonna lie, Doom's not like my the number one guy that I check for.
Yeah.
Even though I own everything that he's out. But I don't know, man. It's just some stuff that's.
Yeah.
Just, I guess, over my head musically.
Yeah, I would say the same thing that you're saying now. Back in the day, I guess when he was doing more stuff, especially like when the Mad Villain joint came out, I would agree. Like, at that, I mean, I wouldn't have agreed with you at that time because I was thinking dude was like...
Mad Villain was tight.
Yeah. But... over time, anything that he's released, to be honest with you, he seemed a little like, almost like it was lazed ball, almost like he wasn't putting that same a Mad Villain energy towards it. You know what I'm saying? So yeah, I was still if that would happen, that would be great, man. I know he did a joint with JJ something. A producer named he from the UK that moved to New York.
I know you're talking about.
And I didn't hear the whole thing. Some of the joints that I heard, I was feeling, but you know, it's like trying to.
Like, it's either you really love Doom, mm-hmm. or you just don't understand.
Yeah, because I know a lot of my...
I fall into the just don't understand him category.
Yeah. Oh, okay. This joint I made recently, you know, Dilla, you know, rest in peace, Dilla. Everybody knows the Questlove story about how he did the little brother beat. And so I have before, if you look at my Elements beat series, have re-chopped and made that beat, the little brother beat. However, I got the sample and said maybe I can try to make a beat of my own. And this is it right here, just a little snippet beat. My little rendition, little brother. No, whatever, something a little different. Also, what I would like to tell the people is that Elements the Beat series, a lot of people have been messaging me, asking me when Elements the Beat series will come out again and everything. Actually, starting in April, we will be starting to edit and release the footage that we have, and also making new episodes of Elements, the Elements Beat series, and stuff. Had the camera break on me and everything, and just haven't had the time to edit what I have for Elements Beat series and things like that. But I definitely want to start releasing that again for the people, and I appreciate all the supporters too as well for supporting that and everything, those beat tutorials. And I'm sure you will probably attest to this, Gadget, but a lot of people there's so many beat tutorial videos out there, and to be honest with you, I didn't want to be just that other beat tutorial dude. I want to do something a little different, along with the beat tutorials, like maybe feature machines that people don't often use. Like, a lot of people know about the XL, a lot of people know about the 25, but I wanted to do tutorials on the 3000, the 60, show people how to track into Pro Tools. But not only that, but you know, show what's going on in DC as far as the DC scene. I have footage at some records, and
hold up.
Yeah.
Is this the footage of you taking your MPC to the record store and sampling their records?
No, it's not. But
aren't you banned from songs?
No, I'm not. Me and Neil happen to be cool, and he recognized. You don't mind me tell you about the situation that happened, do you?
I can't believe you did that.
Basically, everybody, this is what happened.
Hold on.
Records versus Logic Bomb situation. Big up to Neil, by the way. Anyway. For some reason, the electric went out over here. As a matter of fact, we got a letter on the door saying that because they're doing building around Sherner Road Southeast or whatever, that, okay, the electric will be off all day. At the time, I was working with Clyde Piff. Big up to my man Clyde, a.k.a. Good Brother Clyde. I had some tracks to do for him, so I'm like, dang, I can't, where am I gonna go to make these beats, right? There was a few samples that I had, other stuff I had to get, so make a long story short, I drive out to some records, 14th and U, I bring my MP in there, dap up Neil, and say, yeah, man, I'm gonna look at these records. He didn't even look at my bag and see, like, that I had an MP in the joint. So I went in there, set it up, hooked it to his equipment, his turntable, and everything, and started digging on the spot. Got a few records, got a few joints that I was already looking for that he happened to have, and some joints that I was like, oh man, I want this sample. You know what I'm saying? Because y'all know about these. Y'all know about these. In the 2500, once you save the sound in this, that's it. So basically, that's what I was doing. Man, why did Neil come over? He said, Will, what are you doing? What are you doing? I was like, oh, man, my bad. Oh, well, see, man, the situation that I told him, the situation, the electric was off and I needed the samples. Man, this dude got so red. And I thought, like you said, I was about to be banned. I thought I was finished. I thought I would never be able to walk in the store. But he was like, I said, you know what? Every beat, every sound, every record that I used before he came over, I said, I'm going to buy them. So I bought the records that I snipped from. And you know what I'm saying? That I sampled. And I was like, no disrespect to you, Neil, you know what I'm saying? Or to your establishment, man. I just got to make these straight.
Hold on, B. Your no disrespect was so disrespectful. Because you walked into a record store and started sampling records on your MP.
Man, it was just like, you know what I'm saying?
Nothing clicked and said, this might be wrong.
Actually, yes. when I first did like the, I was like, something doesn't feel right. You know what I'm saying? But the joints, the beats got to the artist. Neil and I was cool. He knew there was no sweat. I came out with the records, purchased that I sampled off of, and by the time I got home, about 4 or 5 hours later, the lights came on and I got to get busy.
So did you unhook your MP?
Absolutely. ASAP. slid it right back in the bag and continued digging or whatever. So like I said, it was no problem. It was a problem. But, you know, Neil knows me and he knows I'm a regular at the store and everything was cool. So, So that was...
Yeah, I've heard of people stealing records. I've heard of people just doing unimaginable things to get records out of the store. Throwing them out of second-story windows, then running downstairs grab them.
What? But does this take
I'm not going to say who.
Okay.
I'm not going to say who.
Out the second story?
It was a snowstorm and they threw the records out the window. They just landed in the snow.
What? I'm trying to think of any two-story record places.
It wasn't here.
Oh, okay. I was about to say, was this the DJ Hut days?
No.
Okay.
No, it wasn't here. But you actually took an MPC into a record store and just started sampling records.
Yes, sir. Yes, I did. I have to admit that.
You're amazing.
You know, I repent for my sins. And I really, you know what I'm saying? that was a crazy day. I felt kind of bad that day. But Neil and I, we were eye to eye on the matter. That was like, what, 2 years ago or something like that? A year. Yeah,
it's regardless like three.
Of when it really, yeah, it's been that long, like 2011 or something. But yeah, I started feeling the pressure again, man. Once you know, telling that story, but yeah, that's what happened, Gadget. That's what happened, folks.
You wanna plug anything before we sign out?
All right. Well, the website that you can check out is my Bandcamp page, www.logicbombmusic, all one word, logicbomb music with a K, .bandcamp.com. Follow my Instagram, logicbombmusic. Again, logicbombmusic. And got my Facebook, William Wade, or whatever. Shout outs to everybody, DMV, DC. And big up to everybody and keep doing the music, y'all. Yep. Big up to Gadget and everybody else.